Prime Minister, what positive solution will you be proposing to meet your obligation?
The Labor Party as a cattle dog running around in the back of a ute, she said. Run across to one side, yap, yap, yap. Run across to the other side, yap, yap, yap.
The member for Sturt is warned.
And Mr Speaker, I do get passionate about this because this is incompetence.
Will the minister direct Defence to cease this cost-shifting and honour its obligation to provide appropriate medical treatment to reservists?
This is really a chart, Mr Speaker. And anybody can anybody can understand. It starts here.
Leader of the opposition.
There's you, and there's me.
The leader of the opposition.
I'm bigger than you. Thank you.
Australian politics is a house divided. At question time in the Commonwealth House of Representatives, two political opponents, the Australian Labor Party and the Liberal National Coalition, engage across the chamber. It is a battle of wills, a battle of ideas and of ideologies.
Australian politics is party government. The two terms are virtually interchangeable. The Labor Party had its first meeting the day before the first Parliament met, and in a sense that is symbolic of the way the Parliament's operated for the whole of the century.
There is no formal role for political parties in the Commonwealth Parliament. The Constitution setting out the rules and structure for the Parliament does not even mention them. Yet the two major political parties, Labor and Liberal, have defined the history of the House of Representatives for almost 100 years.
Money is being invested, new research is being encouraged, and Mr Speaker...
Australia's sons, your flag unfold, and proudly wave the banner high, that every nation may behold a glorious standard in the sky, a banner flag that all may see, a proudest boast is liberty, a banner flag.
On the afternoon of the 9th of May, 1901, after a morning of celebration marking the opening of the first Commonwealth Parliament, the members of the House of Representatives convened for their first sitting in the Victorian Parliament House.
Rejoicing treasures beneath the earth, in precious gold, in store profuse, grant us to know its noblest worth.
As the members found their seats, George Houston Reed settled into his place on the Speaker's left. Reed, for 5 years the Premier of New South Wales, was known for his razor wit and ruthless tactics. He was a shrewd and pragmatic politician, but he also held a vision for the Federal House of Representatives.
We are here as the representatives of Australia to lay the foundations of sound national principles. What model are we to substantially follow? What model will we prefer to take as the one that must be followed more closely than any other? The British. For if there is one merit by which the British Constitution is distinguished above every other constitution in the world, it is the lesson which it affords of firm, flexible, incessant, popular control over the instruments of executive power. George Reed.
There's a presumption on the part of many members that Parliament will be like Westminster, filled with independent members of Parliament who, faced with a difficult question, consult their conscience, consult the electors, and then decide on the merits of the proposal.
Reed hoped the new House would be an arena for argument and debate, a place where members would form and change opinion, support or oppose the government as their conscience demanded.
While every member has an obligation to represent their constituency, that's what they're elected to do, they are elected as members of the Federal Parliament, and as such I think my national obligation exceeds my individual obligations to groups in my constituency. So while I may have groups that may lobby me for what seems for a very reasonable concession on their behalf, if it affects the national interest, my obligation is to say to them, look, in the national interest, this is what I am doing as a member of the Federal Parliament.
Thank you. The members who arrived in Melbourne to take up Reid's hopes for the Federal House of Representatives were a mixed lot. What most of the members of the first House of Representatives shared was political experience. 60 of the 75 members had sat in the colonial parliaments, 10 had been colonial premiers, and another 20 ministers. They were not political novices.
Most of the founding fathers had been members of parliament, so they were recreating the type of chamber in which they had been working, and they brought to it all the political tactics, all the political sharpness which they'd had in those houses. So although the constitution doesn't describe in any detail precisely what they were trying to do, this was all taken for granted. And they brought with them as well a lot of the tactics of the colonial parliaments. It wasn't for nothing the New South Wales parliament was called the Bear Garden of Macquarie Street. I mean, the violence of the debates there was quite legendary.
The members remembered the political lessons of their colonial parliaments. And first among these was the importance of alliance, of coalition, in getting things done in the House.
The Parliament did not work out as the Founding Fathers, and they were all men, hoped. I think they were very much expecting a lively body full of independent members who kept their own counsel and who decided on the merits of the proposal. What they got was a Parliament very quickly dominated by political parties.
Across the chamber from George Reid sat his great rival, Alfred Deakin. Deakin was intellectual and charming, but also reserved. He loved books and letters, kept an extensive diary of his spiritual reflections, and believed firmly in ghosts.
In 1901, the two party leaders, Alfred Deakin and George Reid, actually ran national campaigns. That's travelling around the place, talking at meetings, 20, 30, 40, 50 meetings around the country with the transportation of 100 years ago by train. And it was quite clear that they were regarded as the party leaders.
The members of the House formed into loose political groups. These groups were strategic alliances, depending on the art of persuasion to hold together. Members might agree to belong, but neither Deakin nor Reid could demand obedience or impose discipline.
For the Conservatives, Parliament should be a forum for independent thinkers. And so while they might call themselves the Liberal Party, as it then was, they had in mind only a loose collection of individuals who shared a common philosophy about the world. This marked them in stark contrast to the new Labour members who brought into Parliament a very radical new idea of what it meant to be a political party.
In January 1900, the colonial Labour parties had met in Sydney and agreed to stand Labour candidates for the first federal parliament. One of these candidates was John Christian Watson. Born Johann Christian Tunk in Chile, Watson had arrived in Sydney as a 19-year-old. He quickly found work in the printing rooms of Sydney's radical newspapers. Always tactful and pragmatic, Watson worked his way through the ranks of the trade unions.
A parliamentary Labour Party, to be of any weight, must give a solid vote in the House upon every question as it arises. every candidate who runs in the Labor interest should be required to pledge himself not only to the Labor platform, but also to vote on every occasion as the majority of the parliamentary Labor Party may in caucus decide. Chris Watson.
In 1901, Watson and 22 Labor representatives were elected to the new federal parliament. The day before Parliament opened for the first time, they met in a small, stuffy room in the basement of Parliament House. There they formed a Federal Labour Party, elected Watson as leader, and took a pledge of solidarity. On the floor of the House, they would vote not according to individual conscience, but as one party, the Australian Labour Party.
Our pledge is the fact that when it is a vote, that we will then support the majority decision. I see nothing wrong with that. I regard the Labour Party as not only a family, but almost like a tribe, that you are part of it and therefore you contribute to it. You have certainly have opportunities to object to it and change and have things changed. But then you must, if you're going to have objectivity in it, but if you're going to have results, you must then have a united voice.
The non-Labour members greeted news of the Labour Party's pledge of solidarity with disdain and dismay.
Parliament is not responsible to the people at all. It is responsible to an assemblage of members known as the Labour Caucus, away from the light of parliamentary scrutiny and discussion. You are giving up the grandeur of your parliamentary system, which looks upon ministers not as the minions of a caucus, but as the trustees of a nation. George Reid.
There's a lot of debate in the new parliament, particularly as Conservative members criticise the way Labor Party representatives must do as their party instructs. And the Conservatives say, you're not independent thinkers, you're not bringing your own thoughts to the parliament, you're just doing what your party tells you. And that's the crucial point of difference, they argue, between the Liberal view of parliamentary democracy and the Labor view. But the Conservatives also observe pretty quickly that a highly organised and disciplined Labor Party has an influence out of all proportion to its numbers when everybody else is disorganised. And it doesn't take long before the Conservative parties are as organised and as disciplined as the Labor Party they criticise.
By 1904, the House of Representatives was divided into three distinct camps. Deakin and his supporters were protectionists, committed to government intervention in economic and social life. Reid and the Free Traders believed in an unregulated market. And on the crossbenches sat Watson with the Labour members, ready to use their balance of power to win on issues such as a minimum working wage.
It was absolutely impossible. It could not continue, and it ought not to continue. What kind of a game of cricket, compared with the present game, could they play if they had three 11s instead of two? One team playing sometimes with one side, sometimes with the other, and sometimes for itself. That was a homely illustration of the difficulty which the federal parliament had to solve. Alfred Deakin.
Three opposing camps of almost equal size made for unstable governments. Groups of members changed their loyalties depending upon the issue at hand, and governments formed and fell as they gained and then lost a majority in the House. Then suddenly, there was a new issue dividing the House.
Once the tariff stops being the dividing issue between the non-Labour parties, then the clear logic is for them to say what does divide us, does divide politics, that is the degree to which we want to be socialist. We want to involve the state in the whole range of government activities. Once that's the logic, it was clear that the two non-Labour parties were better working together because comparatively little little divided them.
The Federal Labour Party embraced the socialist cause, but Alfred Deakin and his supporters chose to side with the anti-socialists. In June 1909, Deakin joined together the non-Labour members of the House to form a fusion Liberal Party.
So in 1909, one of the logics for non-Labour was, if we continue to be divided, the Labour Party will win by default. So in 1909, it's a combination of changing circumstances and, as usual, political calculation, which decide that they're better off together in order to try and keep the Labour Party out.
As Alfred Deakin entered the House to announce the formation of the Fusion Liberal Party, the Labour members greeted him angrily, with cries of Judas, Judas. Debate in the House degenerated into uproar. At the end of one particularly vitriolic sitting, the Speaker, Frederick Holder, fell prone from his chair, muttering, "Dreadful, dreadful." A few hours later, he died. The fusion held firm. The new Liberal Party adopted the strategy of the Labour members. On the floor of the House, they would vote according to the party line. In 1922, a third party, the Country Party, later the National Party, joined the House. Rather than threatening the two-party system, the advent of the Country Party merely strengthened it.
By 1910, the Parliament is absolutely divided into two blocks. On one side is the Labour Party, and on the other, the Conservative forces, sometimes a single party, but by the 1920s, a coalition, a Liberal Party and a Country Party, very tightly bound, often sharing the same party room, but operating in the Parliament as a coalition to vote as a bloc against Labour. And this means that by the end of the first decade of the Australian Parliament, the pattern of two warring blocs was firmly established and would remain the basis of Australian parliamentary life in the House of Representatives.
Today, the party system created almost a century ago profoundly shapes the work of the members of the House of Representatives.
Michael, is a division of the House.
In the chamber, governments depend on the loyalty of their party members to pass bills into law.
There are two requirements in the chamber. One is to have people there for divisions, and the other one is to maintain a quorum in the House, so a set number of people to enable the House to continue.
Part of the whip's job in keeping the discipline of the party, is, and that goes for the government whip or the opposition whip, is to ensure that people turn up for divisions and if you're the government for quorum so that the House doesn't collapse. If a person doesn't turn up and they've got a good reason and it's only happened once or twice, then you'll say, okay, fine. If a person's a consistent offender and has obviously decided that what they're going to do is just make your life difficult, well then, if someone makes my life difficult, I make their life difficult, and I know that Michael Ronaldson, the government whip, does the same.
It's really just about reinforcing with people their own responsibility. Well, I can't throw them on the ground and jump on them. I can only appeal to their sense of, of being part of the team, and to encourage them to do it on that basis. And the first time they missed it, I've been very nice with them. And the third or fourth time, it got a little stronger.
I thank you, Mr. Speaker. I rise this evening to bring to the attention of the House the question of legislation being passed with regards one vote, one value.
With party discipline ensured, members' ability to dominate the House through eloquence and argument has become less important. For many, the party room has become the centre of debate, the place where the real decisions are made.
The House is a very sterile debating chamber. It is only a contribution to the Hansard that occurs. It is not a debate. We don't see the sort of forensic detail of debate that you see in the Senate. And the question and answer debate, the detailed debate, you rarely see that in the House. And indeed, the opposition rarely introduces substantial amendments in the House of Reps. They defer that to their senators. Now, which is the House of Representatives? Who are the legislators?
As far as the party room is concerned, I've been heard to say that if I were to die and be cremated, I wouldn't mind if my ashes were left on a windowsill in the party room, because some of the best experiences of my life have been there. The most honest debates occur in the party room, the sharpest exchanges, and I have witnessed in the party room, obviously, leaders and prime ministers under pressure and under obligation to change a particular piece of legislation because the party room believed that the executive had got it wrong. I would take the party room and place its debates in the chamber. Now, I've never sat in the party room of the Australian Labor Party, but I suspect most of my Labor Party friends feel exactly the same way.
When you think about each person coming into Parliament, if they were all independents, you would have no cohesion, you would have no ability to pass legislation, and in fact many parliaments throughout the world that lack the maturity that we have in this Parliament suffer because they don't have cohesive political parties and people are jumping from side to side or view to view, and they're bringing down governments and you can't get that cohesion.
This government has made record provision for health in all areas in the time that it's been in government, Mr. Speaker.
Party discipline has allowed the executive government, the leadership of the majority party, to dominate the parliament. In the House, on every vote, the executive know they will get their way.
I actually think that there is not enough choice in terms of the way we vote on various bills. I believe that there should be core issues and bills that we should be required to vote on as a party. But others should be regarded as peripheral, that we can actually determine how we're going to vote. And so instead of being directly responsible and accountable to our party for it, that we're responsible to our electorate for it. And that's, of course, why we're elected. And so the people can lobby for it in my own electorate, and people can then judge you at the end of the term as you how you have performed according to those criteria and how they see your voting pattern. And I think it would create, would put ministers on their toes more. It would provide a greater degree of accountability and discipline in the party.
Party solidarity in the parliament means that the executive dominate the parliament. But who are the executive? In Australia, the executive are all members of parliament. The parties are the ones who actually control the executive. The executive might control the parliament, but the members control the executive. And I think that's a good thing. I think it's given us a great deal of stability in this country, which is forgotten by a lot of people. Like we are probably the most stable democracy in the world.
The House of Representatives was founded on the democratic principle that the wishes and interests of the people should shape the actions of the government. If political parties have made the House what it is today, have they helped or hindered this principle? Is the House all it could or should be? Thank you.
Canberra is probably one of the shattering disasters of Australian history, fond of, as I am of it as a place. I think if the capital had been placed in somewhere like Melbourne and Sydney, both the Parliament and the administration and the media would have partaken of the richness of a real capital city, both politically and culturally. It would have been much more diverse, it would have been much less prone to capture. And I think in a sense it might well have promoted a very wide sense of regional diversity, a genuine idea of interaction between a capital city and the other places in the Federation.
On an autumn morning in 1913, the Prime Minister of Australia, members of the Commonwealth Parliament, public servants, judges, churchmen, generals and admirals travelled to the site of Australia's future federal capital. There was not much to see, but the crowd gathered on the slopes of Camp Hill was anticipating a great event.
We are here as visible signs of a continent. The people are incapable of nourishing abstract ideals. They must have a symbol. Here we have a symbol of nationality. Billy Hughes.
After a decade of argument about where to put them, the foundation stones for Australia's capital city were laid. Lady Denman, the wife of the Governor-General, stepped forward and proudly announced that the city would be called Canberra. And reporters lost no time in tapping out the news on the telegraph lines to Sydney. The ceremonial crowd soon departed for Sydney and Melbourne, leaving the dusty paddocks to the builders. At the base of Camp Hill, an elegant white Parliament House began to take shape. Over the next 30 years, as Australia was transformed from a collection of states to a unified nation, the federal government and the House of Representatives in which it is decided would become Australia's political heart.
You have to begin at the beginning, and that is that the states pre-existed and federation brought together. Six existing political entities with their own constitutions, their own parliaments, their own governments, their own governors, their own everything. To persuade them to come together in a federation, it was clearly important that that be left relatively undisturbed. Of course, certain powers had to be conferred on the Commonwealth. That was the whole point of federation. But if you look at the principles on which the framers began debating the Constitution, both in 1891 and in 1897, the thrust of those was to say that, in essence, only the minimum necessary powers would be transferred to the Commonwealth, leaving the former colonies now to become states otherwise intact.
In October 1911, Sir John Forrest sat in the Commonwealth House of Representatives and smiled as the members agreed to build Australia's first major public work. Explorer, politician, the Emperor of the West, Forrest had argued for decades for a road of iron linking the states. Now the House voted £4 million to construct a transcontinental railway linking Port Augusta in South Australia to Kalgoorlie on the Western Australian goldfields. It was the British Army who finally persuaded Forrest's opponents. They decided that Australia would best defend its corner of the empire when crossed by a railway. In 1917, the first transcontinental express left Port Augusta. 1,692 kilometres and 3 days later, Forrest stood on the platform in Kalgoorlie.
From today, East and West are indissolubly joined together by bands of steel, and the result must be increased prosperity and happiness for the Australian people. Improved means of communication will, I believe, create a broader and nobler national life, while closer union will, I feel sure, mean a wider sympathy with our kinsmen in the old land and with the British people throughout the world. Sir John Forrest.
The railway, like the federal parliament, linked together the states of Australia, but it did not make of them a single unified nation. The Commonwealth Parliament did not lead or drive or control the states or the people who lived in them. Not yet.
It's a long way to Tipperary. It's a long way to go.
In August 1914, Britain declared war on Germany, and Australia, with no independent declaration of its own, was also at war. Australian soldiers became part of British forces, and the Australian Parliament only learnt how its troops were faring when the British command had time to tell them. They heard of Australians fighting at Gallipoli, 4 days after the first troops climbed ashore. At home, the crisis of war demanded from Australia a national response. Suddenly, the states had to work as one.
Probably from about the beginning of World War I, running through into the 1920s, there are a series of events that create a certain consensus in what you might call the intellectual or the ruling class in Australia, that central power should be augmented. Probably the defining event was in fact World War I itself. When you start fighting total war, that suggests to people, rightly or wrongly, the need for strong central power.
The Commonwealth Parliament passed the War Precautions Act, giving the federal government new powers to fix prices, control factories, intern aliens, and censor news and opinion pretty much as it liked. The federal government, and at its helm the Prime Minister, began to decide the course of the entire nation. In 1915, Billy Hughes became Prime Minister of Australia. A small Welshman of great energy and sometimes violent temperament, Hughes had worked in turn as drover, fencer, deckhand, shopkeeper, and mender of umbrellas before being elected to Parliament.
Germany is today the best organised nation in the world, and it is to this fact that she owes her tremendous strength. There is no aimless rushing hither and thither, no dissipation of energy through divided control. Until we organise on a national basis, we can no more hope to conquer in this war or hold our own in the field of industry and commerce than a mere mob could hold its own against a disciplined army. Billy Hughes.
At home and abroad, Hughes argued for a united Australia. Australia would remain a part of the British Empire, but it would also stand on its own 2 feet. At Versailles to negotiate the peace treaty, Hughes insisted that Australia would sign the treaty in its own name, as an independent nation.
Australia had gone through the First World War. That had been a very bonding experience, clearly, for the nation, so that there was more of a tendency to emphasise national power. Moreover, we were well on the way to independence at that point, still not quite there, but Australia had participated in the Versailles peace treaty process, had countersigned the Treaty of Versailles with the rest of the empire, and so on. So again, that tended to emphasise nationhood.
When Billy Hughes arrived home from France, he travelled across the continent on Sir John Forrest's great road of iron. At every stop from west to east, the people turned out to cheer him. The Prime Minister was a national hero. On the 9th of May, 1927, the Duke of York arrived in Canberra to open the new Commonwealth Parliament House. Tradition dictated that the Speaker of the House or the President of the Senate should welcome the royal guests, but Prime Minister Bruce intervened and took the starring role himself. Prime Ministers had become national celebrities. A new government saw the film cameras roll and newsreels rush to theatres around Australia.
Welcome very cordially the opportunity extended to me through the medium of Fox Movie Tone News to address a message to the people of all countries of the world. I am taking this opportunity of introducing the members of the new ministry. The majority are already well known to most of you, but some have not previously held ministerial office. The Cabinet all recognise the responsibility they bear in relation to the people.
From one of the most dramatic Australian political crises for years, Mr. R.G. Menzies, newly elected United Australia Party leader, emerges as Prime Minister. At a time of international tension, he takes up the task of leading Australia.
I'm very sorry to make an appearance in this battered shape, but the fact is that I had a very unsuccessful argument with a Canberra footpath yesterday. However, here I am, leader of my own party, for better or for worse, and looking forward to an attack on the great problems of Australia as the leader of that party.
But not all Australians appreciated Canberra's growing importance. In 1933, the Premier of Western Australia declared his dissatisfaction.
We simply cannot afford to continue as a member of the Commonwealth. The Commonwealth has grown and extended its powers in every direction until last year, the cost of federation most assuredly absorbed more than the total cash profits of the whole of Western Australian industry. Commonwealth policy has resulted in building up large industrialised centres in the eastern states, but that is not a policy which helps Western Australia. I repeat, we cannot continue to pay the cost. Sir James Mitchell.
The people of Western Australia voted to secede from the Australian Federation, and South Australia and Tasmania threatened to follow suit. But the Commonwealth could only be broken peaceably by the British Parliament amending the legislation that had established the Australian Federation. In London, the Western Australian delegation presented their case. But bowing to pressure from Canberra, Britain concluded that it could no longer intervene in Australia's internal affairs. And then internal dissatisfaction was overwhelmed by threats from beyond Australia's borders.
It is our privilege tonight to introduce the Prime Minister, the Honourable John Curtin. Ladies and gentlemen, the Prime Minister.
Men and women of Australia, we are at war with Japan. That has happened because in the first instance, Japanese naval and air forces launched an unprovoked attack on British and United States territory. Because our vital interests are imperiled, and because the rights of free people in the whole Pacific are assailed.
In December 1941, as Japanese forces moved through Southeast Asia towards Australia, Prime Minister Curtin made Australia's first independent declaration of war. The Prime Minister defied the wishes of both Britain and the United States and ordered Australian troops home to defend Australia.
War has indeed come to Australia and increases in intensity. Rabaul, one-time capital of this Australian possession, has been blasted by wave after wave of bombers, and attack by sea is momentarily expected. AIF, militia, and native troops will meet the assault. Japan strikes on a 3,500-mile front from Rabaul to Singapore.
The Commonwealth Parliament extended the powers of the federal government further than ever before, granting the government complete control over prices, profits, investments, materials and manpower, over almost every area of national life.
The full cabinet today directed the War Cabinet to gazette the necessary regulations for the complete mobilization and the complete ordering of all the resources, human and material, in this Commonwealth for the defense of this Commonwealth. That means clearly and specifically that every human being in this country is now, whether he or she likes it, at the service of the government to work in the defense of Australia.
Australia was a united nation. Every resource and person mobilised through the central hub of the federal government in Australia's independent interests. The waging of war required funds, and for the federal government, those funds had to come from taxes. At Federation in 1901, the states had retained control over income tax, but in 1942, with war expenses pressing, the Commonwealth Parliament passed four bills giving the federal government the power to collect income tax. The state governments went immediately in protest to the High Court, claiming that the Commonwealth had no constitutional right to effectively prevent them collecting income tax. But the High Court found for the Commonwealth, and the federal government gained a monopoly on income tax.
Nine o'clock, Wednesday morning, August the 15th, 1945, and it's peace. Peace at last, and Sydney goes wild in delirious celebration of the long war's end. Martin Place is packed with...
With victory in the Pacific, the federal government relinquished control over many areas of national life. The Commonwealth did not, however, give up its control over taxation.
...tremendous hour of the Day of Days. Peace. It's wonderful.
The Second World War had a profound impact on the relationship between the Commonwealth and the state. One impact generally in the sense that it tended to continue that process of we must centralise or perish. The second, more specifically, of course, was that it saw the states in a position of having to surrender most of their powers in relation to tax, and particularly income taxation, which effectively they've never recovered. And that really put the seal on the fact that the financial arrangements between the Commonwealth and the states institutionally under our constitution have favoured the Commonwealth and thereby tended to promote state dependence.
With control of the purse strings, the Commonwealth Parliament turned to building the nation's infrastructure.
Commonwealth financial power has grown dramatically over the last 100 years. And the consequence of that was that the Commonwealth was able to influence other areas of government activity, clearly not within its own sphere of legislative power, through the power of the purse. So education, health, transport, all of those areas were open to Commonwealth influence through giving money to the states on condition that it was spent in a particular area in a particular way. And that's been very important.
Victoria docks Melbourne. The Mesa, first of the post-war immigration vessels to arrive in this country, is awaited by thick crowds giving welcome to friends and relatives. All types from a dozen European countries clutter the ship's side for the first glimpse of the country which is to be their home.
The Commonwealth government is determined that its migration plan shall succeed. If we are to survive as a nation, it must succeed.
After the war, Australia expanded quickly. Immigration and a baby boom among the nation's established inhabitants saw the country's population grow.
Australia's future is in the hands of the babies of today. We are the first 10 million. They are the first of the next.
With many more constituents and more legislation to consider, the Commonwealth Parliament voted in 1948 to almost double its size. The number of members of the House of Representatives increased from 75 to 121. In 1951, the Commonwealth Parliament celebrated its 50th birthday. An independent, unified Australia now looked to Canberra as the centre of national political life.
It's fitting tribute to 50 years of nationhood. May the next 50 years bring even greater prosperity to this land of great destiny, and may her democratic beliefs and institutions remain forever steadfast.
Since the 1950s, the federal government and the Commonwealth House of Representatives in which it is formed has continued to grow in importance at the expense of the states.
Good morning and welcome to Parliament House. Now, the story of Parliament House, however, doesn't really start in 1988 when it was opened. It doesn't really start in 1980 either. It really starts right back in...
But the founders of the Australian Federation always intended that the states would retain a voice within the Commonwealth Parliament itself.
Essentially, the federal parliament is what we describe as a bicameral parliament. In other words, it has two houses of the parliament. The lower house, the House of Representatives, is the so-called popular house that represents people by reference to numbers of population. And the upper house, the Senate, represents, in our case, the states on an equal basis, or the people of the states on an equal basis.
It was always recognised that the government would be formed in the House of Representatives, but the Senate had a fundamental function of protecting states' rights. And so in that sense, they were co-equal houses, in exactly the same way as the Commonwealth and the states were co-equal under the Constitution.
But over a century, the role of the Senate has changed. There is now no clear forum for the interests of the states in the Commonwealth Parliament.
What's happened since 1901 is that the Senates have become the tool of political parties. The senators have become tools of political parties. And certainly there are more parties there than in the House of Representatives often. But they're still the tools of their political parties rather than the states. Now, that was totally the wrong idea from what was actually predicted and hoped for by the founding parents of the nation. What they were hoping was that we would actually have the states or the old colonies still have their strong influence. They lost that influence and the parties gained the influence.
I think the Senate has always functioned as a very important voice for the states, and it functions in a place that nobody sees, the party room, and party committees too. The equal representation of senators by state is an important factor in terms of injecting into the party rooms, regardless of how poorly a party is doing electorally in terms of the House of Representatives, a certain critical mass of voice from a given state.
Today, the House of Representatives is the dominant chamber of the Commonwealth Parliament. The Prime Minister and the Leader of the Opposition sit in the House. And it is the House that controls money bills, introduces taxation, and authorises spending.
Thank you, Mr. Speaker. As the Minister knows full well, we did not oppose the bill when it went through the House.
That is not a point of order.
The culture is different in the Senate from the House, and making the transition is quite hard.
I decided to make that move because I wanted to be in the chamber where government is formed. And that's where the Prime Minister and the Treasurer are. They're the most important people in government, and that's where most bills originate, and I wanted to be in the chamber where government is formed.
Member for Blair. Thank you, Mr. Speaker. Mr. Speaker, my question is to the Prime Minister. Has the Prime Minister's attention been drawn to comments about GST revenue and improvements to school funding? What is the government's response to these comments?
Prime Minister.
Well, Mr. Speaker, as it happens, my attention has been drawn to some comments, and those comments have been made by a successful Labor leader, the Premier of Queensland, Mr. Speaker. The Premier of Queensland, Mr. Speaker, and he had some very interesting things to say last week about the link between education funding and the goods and services tax. And may I say,
the states may have lost influence in the Parliament, but Australia remains a federation. Power is still shared between the states and the Commonwealth. So who should hold the upper hand?
Canberra itself, the institution of Canberra, look, is another country. You know, I come down to Canberra here and hear the issues of the day, so to speak, from, you know, the press gallery and the newspapers. Go home and my people say to me, is this all you've got to think about down there? Tell us the real work that's happening. There's a huge gulf between what Canberra sees as important and politically correct, if you like, and what ordinary Australians are concerned about.
In a country of the geographic dimension of Australia, it's very important for services to be delivered at the place that they're required and in the manner that they're required, and state governments can do that. And Canberra can become a little remote from those sorts of day-to-day grassroots issues, not through any fault of any particular people, but that's the way it works out. If you have a central focus, then you can get out of touch with the day-to-day happenings in Port Hedland or Broome or Albany. And I think state governments do have that role to play, just as I believe local governments have a role to play in that regard.
People do now stand up to be proud Australians, but we are still state by state. I find, for example, it offensive that one of my constituents who would be transferred to Queensland or Victoria cannot put their child in the same education system because it differs. And yet we can have months of meetings over the size of a margarine carton on what the shape is going to be because it's got to be the same right across Australia. Well, I think our education system ought to be the same right across Australia. So this is where I believe the Commonwealth can have the direction in by saying to the states, if you're going to have a system A in one state, a system B in the other state, a system C in the other one, and yet if we're going to stand up and say we're Australians, well then we as the Commonwealth Government are now going to give the direction that you all have to come in together and you're all going to have to be a united voice in a united education system, a united health system.
I'm not a supporter of central power. I think central power corrupts and there needs to be a balance, and our federation has got it right. Philosophically it has it right. You've got the six states. They are the counterweight to the central government. It's a check and a balance that's so very important in a strong democracy. And the fact that we have had 100 years of a very stable and strong democracy indicates that that federation concept is about right.
Australia was founded as a federation in which the diversity of the states would balance the unifying vision of the Commonwealth. But over a century, power has shifted to Canberra. Has this given us better government? Thank you. In March 1901, Australians went to the polls to elect the first Commonwealth Parliament. It was one of the most democratic elections in the world.
The Australian Constitution and the achievement of federation in Australia were certainly seen in the Northern Hemisphere, in the developed countries, as being an experiment in democracy. And Australians were well aware of that too, that they were going to set up a form of democracy that would succeed in a way that had never been achieved before.
When the ballots had been counted, 75 members of the House of Representatives took their seats. Some were rich, some were poor. They were all men, and they were all white.
Almighty God, we humbly beseech thee to vouchsafe thy blessing upon this Parliament. Direct and prosper our deliberations to the advancement of thy glory and the true welfare of the people of Australia.
In the 100 years since that first election, Father, the face of the House has changed little. Hallowed be thy Almost name. All the members thy have been men. Come. Almost all white. Done in earth as it
is in heaven. The relationship between representatives and the electorate is based on trust. And I think for that trust to be there, we have to be convinced that people like us are not excluded from the parliament, that this is central to our representative democracy, that people like us, whoever us are, can be elected. So that's why I think it's important that the Parliament reflects not only the spread of opinion in society, but also represents the composition of our society, that it reflects the waves of immigration that we've had to Australia, that it reflects the equality of women in Australia, that it reflects the equal opportunity we extend to those who are different in some way.
I think we've found a good balance. But Mr. Speaker, I'm very pleased to be able to inform the House.
But does democracy depend on who sits in the House? Must the members reflect the diverse people who elect them? Or are we satisfied if members simply hear and respond to our needs? How can the members of the House truly represent us? Airport
in the world to date. And it's a very good outcome, Mr. Speaker, for aviation and indeed for the taxpayer as well.
At the first federal election, Australians who voted for state parliaments could also vote for the federal parliament. But women had won the right to vote only in South and Western Australia. In the other four states, women were not entitled to cast a ballot or stand for Parliament. For a decade, Rose Scott, mother to an adopted son, advocate for social reform, and founder of the Womanhood Suffrage League of New South Wales, had been arguing for women's right to vote.
What is the suffrage in itself? Is it not part of the whole? The whole is that we deserve, first of all, to be considered human beings, and only secondly, creatures of another sex. It is that man will treat woman in the future as his equal, at home as well as in public, and respect her opinion on any matter that concerns herself equally with himself. Rose Scott.
In Scott's eyes, women were not only entitled to vote, but society needed them to vote. Women would civilise public life.
I can imagine no more effectual way of raising the tone of public opinion, of purifying its moral sentiments, than by imparting into public life the woman's influence, and something of that tenderness, refinement, and purity for which women are especially noted. Rose Scott.
Around the nation, women like Rose Scott lectured, argued, wrote letters, published pamphlets, and gathered petitions calling for votes for women. In 1902, as the Commonwealth Parliament prepared to decide the federal franchise, the House of Representatives received 21 separate petitions insisting on women's right to vote.
The law now is, happily, one man, one vote. A bachelor will have his one vote. The married man, happy in his family, whose wife's vote is one which he can command, will have two votes. Whilst the man who is unhappily married, and whose wife will vote in the opposite way, will have no vote at all. There goes one man, one vote. The member for Tasmania.
Upon their acceptance of the franchise, women will enjoy the same rights as men, and they'll have to take upon themselves the same obligations as to labour and legislation. The question is whether women are physiologically capable of doing all that. The member for Kooyong.
As a matter of fact, thousands of women are today compelled to earn their own livelihood under the industrial laws of this country, in the enactment of which they have no voice whatsoever. They have daily to obey the laws and are therefore entitled equally with men to a voice in their making. The member for Parramatta.
The Commonwealth Franchise Bill was passed by a large majority. Australia became the first country in the world to give women both the vote and the right to stand for Parliament. In 1903, Selina Anderson became the first woman to stand for the Commonwealth House of Representatives. She was 23 years old, president of the Piemont Labour League and secretary of the Anti-Chinese and Asiatic League. Her campaign speeches attracted crowds wherever she spoke. But she was not elected. The same act that gave women the vote also explicitly excluded Aboriginal and non-white Australians. A small number of these Australians had the federal vote because they had a state vote. But over many years of federal administration, regulations removed their ability to exercise that vote. Women had the vote, but at the start of the century, they were divided about standing for Parliament. Rose Scott argued that women should only use the vote to persuade male politicians to improve the lives of women and children.
The suffragists assumed that women's major contribution to public life would be as mothers, that this was their special area of expertise, and that they would contribute to public policy through their understanding of how to protect the interests of the home. So in considering themselves maternal citizens, they saw themselves as having an important status in the community, a status that should be recognised by the state. Just as soldiers were paid when they volunteered for military service, or even when they were conscripted for military service, they thought that mothers should be paid by the state for the very important service they were rendering to the community by having children.
In 1912, with an election looming, women successfully lobbied Prime Minister Andrew Fisher to grant a world first, a maternity allowance. On the birth of a child, Australian women would receive from the government an allowance of £5, whether they were married or unmarried, rich or poor, insured or not. For working women, it meant a bonus of almost 5 weeks' wages.
Statistics show that maternity is more dangerous than war. The maternity allowance will protect the present citizens of the Commonwealth and give to coming citizens a greater assurance that they'll receive proper attention at the most critical period of their lives. It will bring comfort to those to whom it's intended to bring comfort generally, and it will benefit the nation. Andrew Fisher.
Australian women had demonstrated that they did not have to sit in Parliament for their voices to be heard. But as with the vote, the maternity allowance was not quite universal. Pacific Islander, Asian, and Aboriginal women were excluded. As a young woman, Eleanor Glencross, president of the Housewives Association of Victoria, had agreed with Rose Scott that sitting in Parliament was a man's job. By the time she was 40, she had changed her mind.
It has been remarked that Parliament is no place for women. If that is so, it's time they got in and made it a fit place for women. Those comfortable free clubs in the Parliament will never be fit for women until women storm the Citadel, figuratively speaking, and bring their housewifely instinct to bear in cleaning them up. There is the greatest need for a few sensible women in Parliament. And the government's failure to handle the milk supply and the fish supply furnishes remarkable examples of this. Eleanor Glencross.
In 1922, Eleanor Glencross, convinced that men would never really address the needs of housewives, stood for election to the Federal House of Representatives. Defeated, she stood in 1928 for the Victorian State Parliament. Defeated again, in 1943, she campaigned once more for a seat in the House of Representatives. At each election, she stood as an independent candidate.
In fact, the major parties, they didn't really see women as being appropriate representatives, whether it was representatives for business interests or representatives for rural interests or representatives for working interests. Women somehow didn't fit the bill. There was also a fear that women should not get entangled in that cynical world of male party politics, that if they wanted to be effective social reformers, they couldn't afford to be sucked into that rather unprincipled world. So this, of course, did not bode well in terms of women entering Parliament.
Glencross was unsuccessful at the 1943 election. But one woman, endorsed by the United Australia Party, was elected. She became the first woman to sit in the Commonwealth House of Representatives.
Today, of course, is an event for me that will bring back happy memories and sad ones. That my advent into Parliament will be productive of some good, I can merely hope. And I think that the first immediate benefit from the entry of women into Parliament is that other women will be induced to take a great interest in political and public affairs in general.
At the time of her election, Dame Enid Lyons, mother of 12 children, was also known as the Mother of Australia. Her husband, Joe Lyons, had served as Prime Minister for 10 years before dying in office on the eve of World War II. In 1943, Enid Lyons took his seat in the House.
I believe very sincerely that any woman entering the public arena must be prepared to work as men work. She must justify herself not as a woman, but as a citizen. She must attack the same problems, be prepared to shoulder the same burdens. But because I am a woman, and can't divest myself of those qualities that are inherent in my sex, and because every one of us speaks broadly in the terms of his own experience, honourable members will have to become accustomed to the homely metaphors of the kitchen rather than those of the operating theatre, the workshop or the farm. They must also become accustomed to the application to all kinds of measures of the touchstone of their effect upon the home and family life.
Dame Enid Lyons certainly saw women's role in public life as housekeeping the state. They were there to bring complementary qualities and complementary perspectives to the men already in Parliament. So she didn't project at all a kind of competitive attitude, rather just as in the home, men and women had complementary roles, so they would in the greater home, which was the parliament or the state. So, but on the other hand, she occasionally had quite interesting little feminist bylines, I suppose. One of her sayings was, "The cock croweth, but the hen delivereth the goods."
In 1946, the hen delivered to Australian mothers an extension of child endowment. From then on, it would go to the first as well as all subsequent children. Lyons considered it her greatest political achievement.
The Cabinet has just been sworn in, and in a few minutes we'll be going back to Parliament House at Canberra to have our first meeting.
Enid Lyons served in the House of Representatives for 8 years. She became the first woman appointed to the Cabinet. Although, with no portfolio, she maintained her major duty was to pour the tea. In 1946, Doris Blackburn joined Lyons in the House. She also took the seat her husband held until his death. By 1951, however, Lyons had retired and Blackburn was defeated. And once again, there were no women in the House. By the 1970s, women had developed a new vision of their role. They were demanding the same rights, responsibilities, and opportunities as men. They wanted to become politicians themselves.
I joined the Labour Party after my husband died, and I was running the electorate of Henty by then, having sort of came through the ranks. Had a lot of stories about it, but it was fun. And then we needed a candidate for Henty. And everyone was discussing Tom, Dick, Harry, Michael, and you know various others. I said, well, forget about them, because I'm going to do it.
In 1974, Joan Child became only the fourth woman elected to the House. 10 years later, six women won seats.
Let's cross over to Senator Susan Ryan, who is on a panel with Peter Couchman.
Very pleased to see that our sitting women members, our three women who won their marginals last time, have scored enormous swings.
Well, Ros Kelly's done extraordinarily well in the ACT, hasn't she?
Yes, well, that's my electorate.
This is quite a remarkable turnaround, isn't it? Because only, 5 or 6 years ago, it was considered to be electoral suicide to endorse a woman, wasn't it?
Yes, we've had to fight against...
The very worst was my first time in Parliament in the early 80s. And I remember all these sort of snide remarks when I stood up once and asked a question of Michael Hodgman. And he said, oh, well, you can come and visit my office anytime you like. And all the boys sort of started to laugh and carry on. And the Speaker then said, would the member for Canberra like to make a personal explanation? And I was just red with embarrassment.
People in Parliament House seeing a woman assumed she was a staffer. I always remember in the evening when we were going home, and it was always very late, Parliament sat till 11:30, something that more women would change. They simply wouldn't allow that to happen. But we were all outside waiting for a car home, and in those days, all the staffers and the members and the ministers would all just line up in a queue and the Comcars would come along, it's very different now, and pick you up and take you home. And I sat in the Comcar and the driver said, "And who do you work for, love?" And I said, "I work for the electors of Philip." And he said, "Sorry, ma'am."
One of my friends, a member of the House of Representatives, gave me a warning when I went in. He said, "Don't be like the Labor women." I think there are 8 of them in the House at the time. "They only ever talk about women's issues. They're single issue members." So I thought, oh yes, all right, I'll heed that warning. And then I started to hear their speeches and they were nothing of the sort. They were talking about all sorts of issues. The difference was that when it was appropriate in debate on a particular subject and there was a dimension to this issue that would affect women in a particular way, they raised it.
Women members insisted that the House of Representatives consider new ideas. By 1987, they had helped achieve legislation making it illegal to discriminate on the grounds of sex, marital status or pregnancy, and they had introduced programs creating equal employment opportunity for women. Today, women still make up only a quarter of all members of the House of Representatives.
Fear and assume that if he calls an election, we'll know before I get on the flight, in which case I won't get on the flight. So do you want to just get an invite from Bachelor's office and...
...as one of the world's great airports.
In 1994, the Australian Labor Party implemented an affirmative action policy to ensure women would occupy one-third of Labor Party seats by 2002.
One of the things that was always put to us was that if you discriminate in favour of getting women into Parliament, that that's a bad thing, that the women would be token women. We always replied, they always said, a woman should be elected or a person should be elected to Parliament on merit. And we always said, unfortunately, they've always been elected by discrimination. Men have been discriminated in favour of. If people were elected to the Parliament on merit, there'd probably be 90% of the Parliament women. So you'd simply had to discriminate in favour of women somehow to get more in.
The system of the Australian business number, as you know, allows the Australian
Liberal women have established networks to train and support female parliamentary candidates.
And I think you'll find that the representation that we have of females is very high from the Liberal Party. And important thing about that is that every one of them got there on merit. I think to say that you got there because there was a program of affirmative action makes you a permanent second-class citizen, because what they're really saying is you couldn't have got here unless you had some help from the blokes.
But it is not only women who have struggled to find seats in the House of Representatives.
If you believe, as I do, that merit is equally distributed between the sexes, and then you look at a group of people, in this case parliamentarians, and say, well, it's not 50-50 men, women, then there's got to be artificial barriers that are stopping good women getting through. And it seems to me that that concept applies more broadly. If we haven't got a parliament that's representing our Aboriginal people, if we haven't got a parliament that's representing people from different ethnic communities, different social backgrounds, different economic backgrounds, then there's something that's artificially stopping those people getting through.
In 1962, non-white Australians and Indigenous Australians were assured the right to vote in federal elections. But there have been few members in the House from a non-English speaking background. There has never been an identified Aboriginal or Torres Strait Islander member.
The House of Representatives does work. It really does. But having a range of individuals there, women, men, but more importantly too, people from across the full spectrum of the community. You know, we don't want to see just lawyers, although my apologies to lawyers, or just doctors, or just professional people. We need people from all walks of life, nurses, teachers, you know, just people who battle their way up sports people. You need to reflect the Australian community at large rather than just, a political elite.
And the reality is that the political parties in Australia are both so thin that they are going to be restricted in the choices that they make until and unless they expand their base and their willingness sometimes even to look outside their immediate membership for potentially appropriate candidates who share a philosophical position.
The Honourable Member for Aston.
But will changing who sits in the House guarantee that the wishes and interests of the Australian people are heard there?
Merit is sprinkled throughout our society. It's not all amongst male lawyers of a certain age. And in order to make sure people are included, I do think political parties, when they're making their selections, and the public generally needs to think about how our parliament really should be a microcosm of our society. And unfortunately, it's nowhere near that at the moment. And I think we would be strengthened if it was, and we would then strengthen our democratic culture if almost everybody in Australia could look at the federal parliament and see someone who looked a fair bit like them in it. And we're not at that stage.
Most of the change that's taken place in Australian politics, and there hasn't been much of it, actually, there's been very little change in the way we conduct business of the parliaments or the political parties, has come about because of the pressuring of groups like Women's Electoral Lobby, the broader women's movement, and other groups who have sought to insert themselves into the process.
Obviously, there's a member from every area represented in the parliament. I think we could do with more rural and regional members, but having said that, if you subscribe to the old country saying, it's not the size of the dog in the fight, it's the size of the fight in the dog. So maybe it isn't the numbers. It's really having people who are prepared to put their case strongly and stand up sometimes and be counted, really counted, to get an outcome.
I think it's important for the House to represent all Australians, to have a range of points of view there, so that we genuinely are able to understand the complexity of this nation in our own discussions, that we don't overlook particular groups because they happen not to be noisy or have access to the resources of persuasion and lobbying, which means that it's better then to have people directly involved. That doesn't exonerate members of parliament from consulting and widely working in the community to get those points of view, but I think it helps if you have people in the parliament itself who come to it from first principles, understanding those needs and interests. It helps, as I say, because it means that the community is confident that they are represented in the parliament directly.
In 1901, Australia was founded as one of the most representative democracies in the world. But what do we mean by representation? Does democracy depend on who speaks in the House of Representatives, or on what is said there?
Thank you. I was in the old Parliament House, and it was a very inefficient place in which to work. Some people had affection for it, I never did. It was totally inefficient. You had no opportunities for any privacy to do any work. You were constantly interrupted. Several members shared rooms when I went in opposition. One was always on the phone or had people seeing them. It was just impossible. You could go to the library, but then this was long before anyone thought of mobile phones. You had no way of getting messages. The whole thing was just primitive, really, and totally inefficient compared with the facilities I'd been used to working in. And we had no staff. It was just pathetic.
When I first came in, I had an office like 10 by 10, and I shared with Al Grasby. It's like a madhouse. You know, if he wasn't entertaining Catholic priests with bottles of red vino, he was typing on his 1812. And if he wasn't there, it was even worse, because the phone rang every 15 seconds, I'd answer the phone for him. Eventually, if I wanted to do any work, I used to leave the room and both of us left it. But, you know, gradually I got my own room, but it was never more than sort of 10 by 12, pokey little place.
It is therefore with very great pleasure indeed that I now turn the first sod to commence the construction phase of this magnificent project.
It's very reminiscent, PM, of those early photographs.
In 1965, the Commonwealth Parliament began planning a new and permanent Parliament House. Australia's population was growing, and the work of the federal government was expanding. In the House of Representatives, new members were finding their seats, bringing new ideas, new skills, and a new style. The Parliament was growing up, and as the trees on Capitol Hill gave way to steel and concrete, the traditions of the House of Representatives were set to change.
Talking to a young man whose brother was killed in Vietnam.
The vital issues which affect the future security of this country.
I'm trying to justify the intervention of the United States of America,
and not only them, but also to embroil the Australians, the youth of this country, in an aggressive war in South Vietnam.
In 1966, the election was a Vietnam election. I mean, it was a really bitter election. I mean, all the candidates who were putting themselves forward for the Labor Party came to the branch that we were at, and they addressed it, and I was singularly unimpressed. Anyhow, after, as I was wandering around, an old waterside worker called Jack Healy, who had attacked me time and time again at the branch meetings, you know, for what I'd said, and disagreed with me and rain, walked over to me and he said to me, why don't you run? And I thought, well, maybe if the bloke who wins it doesn't win, I'll consider running the next time. Well, he ran, because we got clobbered. So I, straight after it was over, I put my hand up.
Well, I was always interested in politics. I saw my principal role, really, as getting into Parliament to help Australia get closer to its neighbours in the Pacific and in Asia. So that was a driving force for me, and when I stood for office, it was in fact in Victoria, although I'd been born and educated in Sydney, but I'd come down as director of the Chamber of Manufacturers, and as such, when the across-the-board tariff cuts quite pointlessly and stupidly decimated a lot of our industry, instead of having a much more rational approach to what was cut, when and where and by what extent, then that was finally the galvanising issue to go in.
Good evening, Bob Moore at the National Tally Room. And the news tonight is that the Labor Party will govern Australia after 23 years in opposition.
Mr. Whitlam is now going out into the garden to join the hundreds of supporters who are just clamouring.
Our generation, the my age group, but what came in the 60s and later on, increasingly, of course, in the 70s, were people who'd been perhaps born in the Depression but hadn't experienced it. We were fortunate enough to live in a time of peace and also a time of unrivaled employment, so that we had new issues. We saw Whitlam as the sort of white knight on a shining armour, who were articulating the views of our generation, the new, you know, things like environment, racism, prejudice, Australian culture, things like that. And certainly it was what attracted me. And not only did he articulate those views, he had programs.
And like poodle dogs, the Liberal Party...
In the first session under the new Labor government, members of the House had to examine, understand and debate a record number of executive government decisions and a record amount of legislation.
...is no longer equivalent to the vote of a citizen in another part of the country.
But we were all sort of a bit concerned after a while that everything was, you know, happening too quickly. Just every day there was a whole raft of new things. Well, I said this to Gough one day, he said, I don't want them to say of me what they said of Harold Wilson. 6 years, and what's he done? I mean, Gough had the program, and come hell or high water, the program was going to be implemented.
Never seen you fellas up so early.
By late 1975, the opposition was blocking the government's bills, and Parliament was deadlocked.
Do you seriously expect Mr. Whitlam to give ground on this today?
Well, we'll find out, won't we?
On the 11th of November, the Governor-General dismissed the government.
Well, may we say, God save the Queen. God save the Queen! Because nothing will save the Governor-General.
The dismissal brought a new temper of political division to the House of Representatives. In 1977, one of the new generation of members, Neil Blewett, joined the House.
I'd always had an interest in politics and I'd taught political science, but I had the view that as a political scientist I should be objective and not be partisan, so I in a way steered clear of politics. I became involved in the movement against the war in Vietnam. That brought me into contact with people in the Labor Party. I made demagogic speeches. They said, well, you'd be good in Parliament. And so in a way, I drifted into Parliament. I had never had the intention of going into Parliament when I was a young man. So I'd describe it as rather drifting into Parliament. I think when one is a backbencher, then the House is the centre of one's life. When I was a backbencher, I went not only to the sort of grand occasions like question time, a big party censure debate and things like that, but I would wander into the House quite frequently to hear a friend speak or to hear a debate on a topic which was of interest to me, even though I was not speaking myself. I would regularly go to adjournment debates because they're often a chance for a bit of fun and participation at the end of the day. And so I think as a backbencher, your life tends to revolve around the House, around the chamber.
Under the new Liberal, National Country Party government, the pace of work for members continued to grow. The Prime Minister and his cabinet drove legislation through the chamber, expecting the House to keep up.
There's no doubt that for many years now, even before when I went to Parliament, there was an increase in the volume of legislation, and the community now seems to need it. It's partly a product of the rate of change technologically, the globalising of the world, the fact that we are ceding authority to supranational agencies, a variety of international treaties that oblige us to do things, the fact that we can't control the environment or corporate behaviour, for example, unless we have international agencies. That requires legislation.
The amount of legislation grew during the period I was in Parliament. The executive put more and more pressure on the Parliament to pass legislation. I didn't have a real sense of that, partly because I spent about a third of my time, the first part as a backbencher, and then 10 years as a minister. And as a minister, you lose the sense, in many ways, of the pressures on the House. You may be contributing to those pressures on the House, but you lose the sense of the House battling to cope.
We get more and more. The result is that the House, unless it's going to sit at least every second week throughout the whole year, can't scrutinise in the detail required the actual provisions as opposed to the intent of legislation.
As ministers introduced more legislation to the House, backbenchers had less time to consider and debate it in the chamber. By the late 1970s, members began proposing that some of this work be done outside the chamber, through a system of parliamentary committees.
A parliamentary committee is usually a smaller group of members than the whole plenum, the whole meeting of the House of Representatives, which is appointed to do things that the House of Representatives itself isn't easily able to do. In the 70s and the 80s, we experimented with both legislation committees and estimates committees. And these committees were meant to first of all, discuss the estimates in the main appropriation bill, similar to committees that operate in the Senate. But there was a different philosophical approach. They were appointed to discover the principles behind certain proposals and to have a look at the policies rather than the intricate detail.
But the experiment with estimates committees was short-lived.
It did cause problems for the Liberal government, and when the Labor government came to power, it was the committees were discontinued, which I thought was disappointing. I'd argued against this, but the weight of opinion was in favour of not having the committees. The argument used was mainly that they duplicated the work of the Senate committees and therefore were unnecessary. But I think there was a genuine concern amongst the executive that these were perhaps could be dangerous.
Whether you say whether you intend...
In 1984, as Australia's population grew, the House of Representatives increased from 125 seats to 148. In the crowded chamber, a new member for Cowper took his seat.
This government will direct $694 million.
Actually, I was 12 years old when I decided I was going to be a member of the National Parliament and Prime Minister. I started high school when I was in 1946, and I was influenced at that stage through the war years as a youngster by Winston Churchill, who had a big impact on me, and also a little later, Robert Menzies as Prime Minister of Australia. Actually, I spoke on the street corners in an election campaign in Sydney when I was only 18. And of course, in my day, nobody got the vote until they were 21. And so, allied with a passionate interest in democracy, which is embodied in our parliamentary system, that's something that shaped my whole life. And eventually, because I was involved in politics, in party politics, right through, I was eventually elected to the National Parliament at the age of 50.
Now even more members wanted to speak. And in 1987, the House took a new look at committees. Building on the model developed by the Senate, the House established a permanent system of House committees and joint committees of members and senators.
The way I see it is that if we do go down, there's no question of regulation insurance.
I supported the committee system reform very much because I did believe this was the best way of scrutinising, as I've said, not just legislation, but existing legislation as well as that proposed and the actual needs that the community...
I noticed in you looking at your bank account or your statement there, you've got a few crook payers.
Yes.
My assessment is 25% of the people you billed didn't pay you, is that right?
Through standing committees, members could investigate all areas of government administration.
Oh, okay.
members could hold hearings with the community, question public servants about their work, and promote public debate. The committees took Parliament to the people, making sure that the opinions of Australians reached the House.
His grandfather died and he had to leave Lismore and got...
If the government were to make a decision that you could have a licence to broadcast tomorrow, but you would do it all at your own cost...
Well, I think that still would be great just to have the opportunity to...
How would you fund it?
Well, if we knew that we could have a licence, well, then we'd get out...
The institution of the General Purpose Standing Committees has had a huge impact, I believe, on parliamentary democracy as it is exercised in the House of Representatives. They've led to better legislation, I think, in that legislation which a ministry may think is perfect has been tested by the general population before it had effect, in other words, without the need for a court case to prove so, and has found that by small changes it could be a much more effective piece of legislation. And I think it's also given a career path to members. It's not uncommon now for a member to be chair of a parliamentary committee and then to be a parliamentary secretary and finally to be a minister.
Committees brought a new style of working to the House of Representatives.
Yeah. Well, I have it. Is this going to be our regular meeting time?
You have members from both sides. The majority is always with the government. That doesn't stop the opposition members from putting in a minority report if they wish to. It's fairly rare because the parliamentary committee system is where the parliament really works smoothly and effectively and efficiently.
I chaired an inquiry into the retail sector and we looked at it from various viewpoints and we ended up with a unanimous report with representatives there of the Liberal Party, the Labor Party, the National Party and the Democrats. And I think that was pretty satisfying. And it was a real situation. And we looked at all the alternatives and came down with recommended solutions. And most of them were adopted by the government. So as a backbencher, I think it's much more satisfying in rather than the, say, the debate in the House.
My warmest congratulations to the architects, to the members of the Parliament House Construction Authority, to the contractors and subcontractors, and to the artists and craftspeople whose creative talents enrich the interior, and particularly to Michael Jacamara Nelson, whose mosaic is in the forecourt. Together, they have given the whole complex a distinctive Australian character. The laws of the Commonwealth of Australia are enacted in the name of the Queen and the two Houses of Parliament. It is fitting, therefore, and a great pleasure for me to offer my best wishes to all those who will be giving their service to the nation within these walls and to declare open the new Parliament House of the Commonwealth of Australia.
In 1988, Queen Elizabeth II opened the permanent Parliament House and the members of the House of Representatives moved up the hill. One of the new members to find a seat in the new building was Bruce Baird. Like many members, he came to the Federal House from a state parliament.
Well, I'd been involved as the Minister for the Olympic Bid in the state parliament, and after that I thought everything's going to be a bit ho-hum. So I decided to leave there and had a few interesting offers, and I went out into the private sector. Then when I was out there for a few years, I had this rather unusual invitation to think about the seat of Cook. And it started, I tossed it around several times, and finally the whole addictive thing of politics started to cut in. And before I knew it, there I was, back in politics again.
legislation being passed with regards one vote, one value.
Having come from state parliament, I was disappointed that the level support of the average debate in the House, because you've often got four people in the House, two from our side, two from theirs. You don't feel as if anybody is really paying a huge amount of notice to what goes on. A lot of the debates, you don't even see the minister in the House. So that I think, from what I understand, that with the building of new Parliament House, with the physical removal of the executive to another part of the Parliament, then it certainly has meant that they are much more removed, that they tend to make a lot of the decisions, and the average backbencher can talk on in the House, but will make very little difference in terms of the outcome of the bill.
In the old House was a very intimate House. You were pressed up against each other, and there was no real separation of the executive or the leaders of the party, the ministers or shadow ministers, from the rest of the members. They just tended to have bigger rooms, but often in the same corridor. So there was an intimacy there which I think you don't have in the new House. I mean, for instance, first of all, it's a real effort to go from being from a backbencher's office across to the ministerial suites in a way it wasn't in the old House.
I would agree with those that say that the ministry has been removed from interaction with the ordinary parliamentarians of both sides, and that is an unfortunate trend. It's one thing to have a division of power, but if you have a division of communication amongst elected people, that really is bad. And I think it's true that the ministers had bigger staffs, better offices, and as a consequence became more and more cloistered away with those, and they tended to employ staff who thought as they did. That's understandable, but it meant they were less exposed to countervailing views, and more mistakes can be made, and they can look more silly in the chamber and in the public eye and in the media.
There used to be a story in the old building that there was no trouble meeting a minister. You simply had to wait in the toilet, and when the minister came to do essential functions, you could ambush them and ask them questions. This was all very well, of course, if you were a male member, and that was a male minister you were talking about. But in the building here, I think the way the chamber operates and the ministry operates in relation to it varies with the individuals.
When you're a new backbencher, ministerial does feel a long way away. I think as you spend a bit of time there, it feels less of a way away. And as you get to know some of the ministers, and I bowled a few union officials into Tony Abbott's office unexpectedly in the last sort of few sitting weeks. And when you've done a few things like that, the sort of barriers break down a fair bit. My active interest in politics really stems from going to university and becoming involved in my second year of university in an education funding campaign. Getting involved in student politics meant people started to say to me, you would be good at this, you should think about going into politics. And I didn't sort of actively seize on the suggestion, but I suppose it put an idea in the back of my mind. And when I'd finished being national president of AUS and returned to university and became more involved in the Labor Party, the idea crystallised from there. And I thought, well, you know, people say I would be good at this, and I'm obviously very interested in politics and develop some of the skills you would need, so I will pursue this as an active option. I was John Brumby's chief of staff when he was Victorian leader of the opposition, and you really got to know a lot about just the media cycle in terms of stories and how they're prepared and when they're filed, and the psychology of it, the psychology of the pack, the tricks in it, the sort of gotcha kind of tricks that there are in it. The, you know, will the minister rule out? Well, you can't, you know, hardly ever rule anything out. You know, story next day, minister refuses to rule out. So all of those sort of little tricks you got to see on display.
Yeah, it was fair of Senator Heffernan to use parliamentary privilege the way.
No longer were the media interested in the discussion in the chamber. The prize was now a doorstop interview with the minister.
So he's now under an obligation to do that?
Absolutely right. He's under an obligation. That's the radio. Is it the
past? When I was first elected, the newspaper gave the Parliament a huge coverage. Speeches were covered, debates were covered. You know, they would say the debate on the sugar bounty bill, and here's a little bit for what, you know, the member for, you know, Malong Swamp said, and so on and so. And if you had somebody to say as an MP that was interesting to the media, they would come and talk to you. It's a backbencher.
It's almost impossible to reach the top levels of politics now without considerable media ability. As yet, you don't have to look like a film star, thank goodness, but there are pressures in that direction, that presentation, looks, ability to give those quick, short grabs, which I was never very good at, because it seems to me that politics is essentially about a lot of hard, complex thinking. I think in many ways that quick 1 minute, half a minute, 30 second jabs, grabs,
the opposition,
in a way demeaning of politics.
He should be asked the question of how he's going to reconcile the view of the industrial branch of the Labor movement in Australia from the view of the sound thinkers in the Labor Party, like the Queensland Premier. Now, he was on, the Queensland Premier is on TV from the United States this morning.
In 1991, Parliament voted to broadcast question time on national television. Now, even in the chamber, the debate was less between the members
the super.
And more for television audiences.
Stand by one. Stand by seven. Take seven.
Thank you, Mr. Speaker. I'd just like to.
Stand by six. Take six. Are we super, dear man? Okay, super.
It is true, I think, that broadcasting, particularly televising question time, has made a difference to it in the sense that it's increased and stressed its theatrical character. Moreover, because of people watching it on television, then both the questioners and those answering the questions direct their responses as much to the public as they do to the House. I think there are both advantages and disadvantages. As I say, in some ways it heightens the theatrical element. In some ways, however, I think it tends to minimise or play down the interaction between people in the House so that it may not be as dynamic as it was in the past.
I think the problem is with the media is that they often dwell on all the negatives that exist, negatives in terms of personalities or factions within parties, personality differences, and the constant pressure they've got of looking for stories so that people can be under pressure. And it may result in people being inhibited in terms of policy development, because it's a lot easier if you don't come up with new policy, because it's, you know, what are people going to criticise you for? How does this work? How does that work? And bring out all the examples of where there's some problems. So that I think the enormous press crew they've got in Canberra, the enormous pressure that they put people under, must inhibit real strategic, significant policy changes within the Australian political environment.
The Minister.
Mr. Deputy Speaker, I move the proposal described as Customs Tariff Proposal No. 5, 1992, in the terms of the printed proposal, which is now being circulated to honourable members of the House.
The motion be agreed to, the Minister.
Following the Government's consideration of the Industry Commission's report on the Australian dairy industry, the Government has decided to extend.
I move that the bill be now read a second time.
This bill will amend the Taxation Administration Act of 1953 to provide.
The purpose of the Sugar Cane Levy Amendment Bill is to amend the maximum rate of levy on sugar cane.
The purpose of this bill is to give effect to the initiative announced in the Prime Minister's One Nation Statement to alleviate.
I move that this bill be now read a second time. A major element of the Government's reform agenda since taking office has been the comprehensive reform of the Australian taxation system.
This bill should be read with the proposed amendments to the Telecommunications Act to be included in the Transport Communications Legislation Amendment Bill No. 2, 1992, which, together with this bill, will enable a fee to be charged.
Vote be made in order of the day for the next sitting. All those that are that opinion say aye. Of the contrary, no. I think the ayes have it.
We're seeing the Parliament used as a cipher.
We're seeing it there and used for the benefit of the executive rather than for the benefit for which this parliament is established, and that is to be a debating chamber which both sides of the parliament are given the opportunity to explore in depth particular issues as they relate to major pieces of legislation.
In this case, the committee shall return the bill to the House for further consideration.
In 1994, members formed the main committee. In this second chamber, they could debate non-controversial legislation that was usually pushed through the House.
The official records of proceedings of the main committee will be the minutes of proceedings of the committee kept by the clerk of the committee, staff, advisers, members of the media.
What happens now? The appropriation bills are referred up to the main committee, and they stay. We normally sit on Wednesday and Thursday mornings, but when we've got the appropriation bills, we sit on Monday nights, we sit on Tuesday nights, Wednesday evenings as well, so that it provides many, many more hours of time for debate, so that members can actually get to say what they want to say. And it's a major step forward. So much so, the House of Commons and the British Parliament has copied us.
My experience of the main committee is that it really mimics the chamber itself. I think it's good that we've got the second debating chamber. It means more people get an opportunity to speak. And the intimacy of it, just the physical intimacy of it, means that you can get a sort of spirited exchange back and forth, which is good to see. But really, its forms are basically the same as the parliamentary chamber proper. And I think we need to take a more, broadly based view about what needs to be done to reform the parliamentary system.
100 years ago, the members imagined that the chamber of the House of Representatives would be a place of debate, a place where members and ministers would discuss the needs of the people. But over a century, governments have increasingly needed the House to stop talking and concentrate instead on passing legislation. As Australia grows in size and complexity, will the House be simply a machine for passing legislation? Or a national forum for debate and ideas?
One of the constant criticisms of politicians is that no one seems to have vision anymore. It's pretty difficult to project vision when you're sort of trapped into a ritual that means that you're speaking to Taxation Law Amendment Bill number, 356 or wherever we are at the moment. And I think if we could break down the parliament so that sometimes we're grappling with issues. I mean, in the Victorian Parliament, for example, even under Jeff Kennett, we had the drugs debate where you had Professor Pennington, who'd done a keynote report for the government, actually come onto the floor of Parliament House, speak to his report. Very mixed views, not party political views, but very mixed views about difficult questions around drug usage, legalisation, safe injecting rooms, all of those sorts of things. I think if we could have more of that, that would actually be good for our public debate as a nation and be good for the reputation of Parliament.
Yeah, it'd be great if we had debates about issues of national importance and we just set aside a whole week. For example, we could be discussing Australia's security alliances, and the mechanisms against terror, so that each person had to consider where they stood and what are the issues that they felt were important for the future. And we get caught up with a labyrinth of legislation and all the normal mechanics of being in Parliament rather than lifting our sights. Now, the same applies in terms of policy. There are few real policy debates.
Health Observers Group, this report is crucial to any subsequent Commonwealth action that may be decided by President Mbeki of South Africa, President Obasanjo of Nigeria, and our own Prime Minister, in accordance with the Harare Declaration and the Millbrook.
Quite frankly, the Parliament should sit more, should be willing to sit even longer, but certainly sit more, and allocate more time for that, and have less time for grandstanding, and a more rational organisation of voting.
I think we've got the opportunity now to look ahead and see what are the greatest challenges facing the House. I think the basic one is how to make sure that the House and its institutions are relevant to the Australian population. We have to make sure that there are avenues and ways for the people of Australia to make their views known through to the House, and for the House to have ways to make sure that it listens and gives effect to those views.
Thank you.